Okay. Now we got grub juice. These should help if you need to restore your depleted reserves of psychic power. You know, that if that's a thing you're into restoring. With both these things in hand, you've got everything you need to perform a respectively complex and lengthy psychic arena stickball maneuver. This stuff really doesn't do your voice any favors, possibly because your throat partially closes up in protest by the time you've finished half a cylinder. Ew. You're actually able to bend an entire spoon without refreshing your reserves with grub juice. You couldn't always, so you suppose that's improvement. Wow. There actually are stats for grub juice in your flart manual due to a regrettable cross-platform brand awareness licensing campaign. Restores depleted psych mana. Well, okay, you'll keep that in mind. Oh, I got that. As soon as you find a good use for your telekinesis, this grub juice will help you accomplish it. We have a good use for it. Usually wait until you finish drinking a grub juice before you smash the cylinder. Alright. Nothing there. All the best chefs cook on very high heat. You're not one of the best chefs, which is just as well, since your crisp range kind of sucks. Besides, how will you know what to cook if Damek doesn't tell you what he wants? Will he show you two of friends and he just takes advantage of you? You should never, ever drink hot grub juice. It's not a memory you want to revisit. The match tip, the number 11 ball, is actually on fire. It's a cinch to deal with if you're a gifted telekinetic, but luckily for you, you can always just smack it away with your Cubat. Sounds like a good way to start some sick fires. You're pretty pleased with that one. You should tell Tetrarch Dem... Alright. Sure thing. All you're missing is a plate, some food, ideally a spoon that isn't bent. The Flart manual has lots of instructions for cooking and other types of crafting. You'll need to make a bunch of burned husk loaf to grind your level enough to be able to cook anything edible, though. You're telekinetic, not pyrokinetic. Jeez. You guess a flaming Cubat might scare off some of those drones outside if they were physically capable of fear. Since they're not, you think you'll take it easy on the burning your only means of defending yourself front. Alright, this and this. You don't put a clock to your drinking. I think we picked up everything else. Aw, dang it, your Lucis is sleeping somewhere totally inconvenient again. Come on, wake up, Zoo smell? What does that mean? Zoo smell is in the way again. For a change. Just keeping things interesting, you guess. Okay, I can name the thing? I didn't know. I thought I was calling it? I don't know. He's very particular about his diet. He only eats sloth treats, and he only eats a lot of them. He tends to rely on a raw, indolent instinct than on tactics. You fire off from the hip with some absolutely devastating verse about your Lucis, and about Lucises in general, and their inability to comprehend the struggles of their wards due to a lethal combination of being too old, too corny, and too much dumb monster animals instead of people. He retaliates by continuing to be asleep. You're wrecked. He just wants his sloth treats. Giving him an empty spoon is kind of rude in that context. He's not really into flarp, and also can't read, and also is a sloth. So he is a sloth. Ah, who are you kidding? You can barely lift a spoon without passing out. If he's gonna be moved, it's gonna have to be him doing the moving. Gotta make him want to, you guys. You'd never take a swing at your Lucis. Not that he'd even feel it if you did. He's very strong. Things are looking pretty dicey out there, but Joey Alien needs your help. I don't think we can exit. Your Lucis is obeying his bestial paternal instincts to protect you from danger by blocking the doorway. Good dad. Best sloth. Either that or he just fell asleep there. I think latter. Alright, let's go. We can mess with stuff with this. Plenty of ads for grub juice in the pusher section of Arena Stickball Illustrated, the only section of the magazine you're legally permitted to read. Who's to stop you from opening it and reading the rest? As usual, your pusher playbook is being torn apart in the review section of Arena Stickball Illustrated. None of the reviews are actually written by pushers, though. It's usually just Violet Blood nobles talking about how it's disgusting that they have to look at Rust's Bloods when they want to watch Arena Stickball. Or just talking about whatever they want, really. If a royal wants to talk about the sandwich he didn't finish earlier, they can get that published wherever they want. Well, that's nice for them. You should really just get some coasters. The lead on this show plays by his own rules. It's cool. On the Velvet, though, that'll get you called. I don't think this will work. No. Oh, that would take forever to get out of the fabric. Slamming yourself against a lounge plank is a great low-cost way to condition yourself for the physical toll of Arena Stickball. It's also a great way to wear out your already crummy furniture. This tree is sustained by water, not, whatever this is. No trees on the Velvet. That'd be a pretty absurd obstacle to navigate. Okay, before I go in here... Oh, I can look at it. You consider using the zigzag incline to move to a different area of your hive. Yeah, I'm gonna look at everything with those two things. Shouldn't take that long. You use a special smear gunk for the smear spinner. You don't just shoot any old gunk in there. You don't really build up any muscle that would be useful in Arena Stickball by pushing the old smear spinner around. It's just too easy. What with all the smearing and the spinning, it practically pulls you along behind it. That was some pretty hollow false enthusiasm if you're being real with yourself. Scouring the floor with grub juice would just sort of be a step backwards. You wonder if the frequent toil of scarab bristling has made you a better pusher. Well, maybe better than you would be without it, but not better than the other pushers, since almost all of them are pushing a scour dray around their hallways, too. Alright. Grub juice isn't gritty enough to get a good scour going. Many of these cleaning supplies could be combined into improvised weapons, but that would be cheating, and Rust Blood cheaters get coal before they can blink. Okay. No grub juice stains on any of these, not that you don't spill on yourself, of course. You just get a lot of practice laundry done during your butler training. Your pusher playbook recommends that you always keep your gear in working order, which is kind of an obvious thing to recommend. It barely counts as a tip. It's also very difficult to actually do, since pushers just get brutalized out there. Winners on Slammer Get Called get tons of sponsorships, but grub juice is really more of a sports-themed beverage-adjacent semi-liquid. It doesn't have the sizzle and glamour of the lifestyle brands that... SOGC attracts. Oh, slam, I get called. You feel like you're being pulled in so many different directions these days. Arena Stickball practice, slam, I get called, the rebellion, the grubbles? In a non-SOGC capacity. Plus, somewhere in there, you're supposed to be training to pass your rights, just in case you can't close the deal off on any of those other interests. Thank goodness you have Tetrachdemic to tell you what's really important. Now, Joey has different interests as well. You could shake it up and spray the chunky beverage all over your nice lighting fixture, but why? Why would you? You love it. It reminds you of your favorite thing, Arena Stickball. You have to account for the effects of all the different balls when you're the pusher, since you're the only one allowed allowed to score. Touch the dozer with your hands, and you fall asleep in seconds. The stitcher is a loose pile of yarn that has to be rolled up into a ball before it can be used to score, and makes a tempting distraction for the opposing team's prowler, etc. The tracer will try to follow the path if it was taken on in the match before, and the finisher will only move on a predetermined path to the goal, hopefully your opponent's. There are lots more. It's a lot to keep track of, frankly. Got it. It's good to hydrate before you sleep. The sopper slime is actually very physically and mentally draining. It's not unheard for it to severely injure trolls who are already in bad health when they go to sleep. So you sleep and get hurt? Your pusher playbook recommends that you should be sure to get plenty of sleep before any big match, which is kind of incredibly obvious, but okay. It's also easier said than done sometimes. You just get so excited. If anyone were to commit the outrageous faux pas of drinking grub juice at a fancy dinner, with all the rules, sharp hazards, and circles, you can almost imagine that your Where Grid study scroll is actually a page from your pusher playbook, if you really, really try. Maybe when you're done with these, you can crush the can with your mind, by which you mean crush it against your nug bone. Your nug bone. Improvised weapons are prohibited on the Velvet, unless you improvise them from something you find on the playing field itself, like somebody's torn off leg or whatever. Then it's fair game. It's important to pour the grub juice down the side of the glass so it maintains its turgidity. You try to tell yourself that your butler training will translate into skills that you can also use on the Velvet playing field of arena stickball, but it's hard to make yourself believe it. Okay. Oh, we have stuff. We have one thing here, right? This poster. You and Tetrakdamic haven't secured any endorsements, obviously, because that would be a betrayal of his principles. Ever since you joined Damek's band, you haven't really had a chance to practice your pusher maneuvers very much, which is fine, of course. It's not a big deal. It's just a dumb game, like the Tetrak says. Okay. Alright, new stuff. I know I'm probably going to use it on that to open the vault. Thirsty little guys? Heh, you're just kidding around. You know they aren't alive. They don't have needs like thirst or hunger or the deep and echoing loneliness that never really leaves you, even in crowds. Aww. It's hard to strategize new plays using these guys when there's just two of them, unless it's strategies for if most of the team has been killed, of which there are many. Okay, you've maybe contributed a little to this helmet being worn out, what with all the empty grub juice cans you've crushed against it. Let's see, helmet? Ah, here we go. Helmet, wear one. These round gaps at the corners and sides are goal sockets, not hydration cylinder holders. Not. The plays offered by your pusher playbook aren't really applicable to tabletop arena. Tabletop arena what? Stickball, right. Since the game is necessarily amplified, there's almost no chance of the tiny plastic pushers being horribly maimed and needing to crawl to safety. Kicking back in your splay sack with a nice grub juice, still turgid from the hunger trunk, sounds nice. You don't do it right now, but you imagine it, and wow, nice. Astonishingly, there aren't any plays that incorporate comfortable furniture. What do you think this is? Yacht racing with a bunch of violet bloods? There's that. Zoltan certainly didn't need cheap pick-me-ups like this to keep his telekinesis going. He was like a river of power that everyone else had to swim in or drown. Wow. Oh, obviously. Like half the plays in here are Matsos originals. He really reinvented the pusher position, brought some real dignity to it. Which is probably why they humiliated and cold him. But they can't kill his spirit. That's right. Grub juice doesn't actually make you better at video games, and they aren't really strenuous enough to make you need to rehydrate. It's like Damek says, brutally authoritarian, capitalist marketing is full of petty lies. The plays are already in the game. You basically just pick which one you want to execute and then try not to screw up too bad. Grub Juice companies are heavy sponsors of the various arena stickball teams, though only at the pro level, of course. Minor league scrubs rely on more arena stickball-centric endorsements like Q-bats or helmets, which barely cover the cost of wear and tear and significant injury. Yeah, this is a pretty classic pusher maneuver. You actually paused it right here in order to get a closer look at her form. Look at how she's pivoting her whole body in the air to give her Q-bat extra heft on impact. She's also giving the bat a nice jolt of extra force from her telekinesis, a pro move that's very difficult to execute properly. Okay. Grub Juice is great after a game, or during. Sometimes you have one right in the middle of the action, just to get you through it. There's a lot of strategies in here for the best way to score with each ball, and how to avoid getting killed by them, and that kind of stuff. A lot about that kind of stuff, really. Okay, I'm not going to use this stuff here yet. Oh. Well, I can't avoid it, can I? I can't really move, like... I wonder if you can beat this without... I beat it anyway! Oh, I didn't want to get rid of that. Do I still have it? Now you can get the sloth treats! What a trial that was! Lucky he has such a slow metabolism. Okay. So I didn't have to use it. I wonder if that gave me an edge. Sloth treats? Nothing else to look at, right? The sloth treats! There they are! Yours for the grabbing! He doesn't really like grub juice, and you really don't like sloth treats, so this really wouldn't appeal to anyone. You think you call this hypothetical recipe the perfect compromise. So yeah, I didn't mean to do that, guys. I just wanted to see what it would say if I used this on that, and I went into it, so yeah. There are dozens of maneuvers for interacting with friendly, neutral, and opposing Lucises on the Velvet. You're just straight up not allowed to feed them, though. This bad boy is not powered by sloth treats, unlike the bad boy who is your sloth dad. Sloth dad? Is this protest art? You make a mental note to tell the Tetrarch later. Maybe he'll be impressed. The Flart manual states that consuming pet food to regain a minuscule amount of HP is a totally valid move, but nobody ever actually does that. Come on. It's a shame your telekinetic endurance isn't potent enough to allow you to lug these sloth treats around without actually touching them. That way you could spare yourself the burden of having them stink up your hands and pockets. The two most necessary implements of sloth wrangling. Alright, grab. You grab the sloth treats. You know just what to do with these. Yes, use them on everything. After all the work you did to get these out, you're gonna hold on to them for a little while at least. Your Lucis's favorite treats. Sometimes you wonder if he's only here for more treats. Well, no, you don't really. It says the same thing. What's it say? Did I read that one? Yeah. The two most necessary implements of sloth wrangling. Sloths aren't really that common among the Lucises featured in Arena Stickball. They don't really make for very exciting blood sport, as they're sort of way the heck too slow. Anywhere you leave them, he's bound to find them, so you'd rather not leave them inside of things you don't want slowly torn in half. You don't have to feed the controller, it's self-sustaining, right up until it dies from starvation. Then the mother console just lays a new one. Really? Okay. So it's self-sustaining but will die of starvation. Oh, that's all he needs, because he's obviously having so much trouble finding a comfortable place to relax. You wonder what kind of Lucis your hero Zoltan Matsos had. You kind of hope that he had a glacial tree trudger, like you. Oh, I forgot to use this with this. So Snow Globes don't have a Grub Juice sponsorship. If they did, that'd be the only brand you drank. Yep, this is the official Thrash Thrust Snow Globes tolerated fan-made pusher playbook. Only the best. He's not really a huge fan. You mean he backs the Snow Globes, obviously, and he's huge, of course, but he's pretty relaxed about his support. You don't want him accidentally eating one of your bobble nugs. Not that he'd choke or anything, you just like these. He'd tear right through this thing, if he ever felt like it. He's really strong. There are no tiny Lucises on the field in Tabletop Arena Stickball, which means the tiny Wranglers really don't have much to do. They just spin helplessly along with their teammates. Alright, done in here. Oh, that sounded scary for a second. He wouldn't eat these if they got anywhere near the Scourdray Resi Fluid. He's such a snob sometimes. Or he's kind of a snob, something like that. You'd rather not poison your pet dad, thanks. So he's your dad? What? Your Lucis might be willing to help you keep your hive clean, but it's important that you get all the practice you can before your rites of maturation. Besides, he'd take forever. In here real quick. Sometimes you think about keeping a couple of extra sloth treats in the pockets of your clothes, just to have them on hand when you need them. But if you could just leave treats out without your Lucis finding them and destroying whatever holds them, you wouldn't need to keep them in a huge vault in the first place. Your biggest fan in every sense. Unfortunately, Lucises are barred from voting, unless you're a high blood, in which case your Lucis can eat everyone on stage if they want to. Yeah, seems a little imbalanced, huh? Your Lucis isn't a huge fan of your band, which is lucky, because wow, that would be embarrassing if your biggest fan was your own Lucis. Hiding a treat up there would just result in your nice arena stickball lamp being torn from the ceiling as your Lucis leapt up to grab it, since there's no way in the world it can support his weight. Lucises don't need to sleep in recuper raccoons, because they are not afflicted with the violent and troubling impulses that your own species is. Or at least your Lucis isn't. There are some pretty nasty ones out there. This calms their violent impulses? There's no point putting the sloth treats in a special dish or anything. He just eats them all, immediately, without even opening his eyes all the way. If you mix these together, the next time you came up here, there'd be a lot few spoons in the pile and a lot more spoons in another smellier pile in your Lucis shed. Your sloth is a low-blood Lucis, and he won't ever have a butler attending to him. Except you, you guys. Alright. Back downstairs. The text isn't as interesting as all the text from Joey, but still kind of interesting learning about the Lucis and everything like that by doing stuff like this. There's no ads for sloth treats in these. It's a pretty uncommon Lucis, so they tend to focus on direct marketing. These are uncommon Lucis. You wouldn't find that out otherwise. Maybe. I still have to go in the kitchen. That'll be next. Nothing happens. You kind of like it when he sleeps on the lounge plank because you can just kind of chill next to him, and it's sort of like you when you were just a little wiggler. his favorite treat and his favorite seat. Alright. Now, I'm not gonna go in there. Go in here. If you went out this way, you'd be an easy prey for a drone before you could ever make it to Tetrachdamix. You mean to save Joey. That's what you meant. Oh, I thought that was the kitchen. Oh, that's the kitchen, duh. It's too dangerous to leave this way. The drones could see you. Safest bet is to go out through the back door. They'll probably spot you there, too, but, well, your hive only has so many doors. Alright, let's go. You don't really schedule his feedings. It makes it easier to tempt him out of your way with a treat whenever he blocks your path with his slumbering enormity, which happens pretty regularly. You guess technically he's scheduling the feedings? Is he doing it on purpose? He prefers them raw. Can't access anything in here, in the inventory. Okay. Here, boy. You got just the thing to get him moving. Here, you. Zeus Mal. Is he waking up? Okay, there he goes. I put it on the table? Oh, okay. So he's just out of the way, which is good. You thank Zeus Mal for getting out of the way. All you had to do was give him exactly what he wanted. Yeah, let me see. There's a whole section about using the time of day. Oh, that's for the clock. Same. Alright. Ah, the crushing ennui and blossoming existential dread of cooking. You keep meaning to give one of these recipes a try, but for some reason the idea depresses you. And there's something else. Your spice rack. It's where you keep your spices. Get out of the way of everything. Okay, we've looked at that. Here we've got a cookbook and a spice rack. Look, cards on the table. This stuff tastes pretty awful. But you think you'd rather just play through the pain than try to church it up with some minced polar bear guts or something. Messing with these might lessen your psychic restorative qualities. Ah, sport. The spice of life. One of these books will end up ruling your future. Hopefully not the one about spatchcocking thump gizzards. Oh, I did that already. Your flow is fresh enough already. It's already spicy, sweet, sour. Yeah, that works. I guess your flow is pretty brothy. There are lots of little songs you can sing to yourself in the kitchen to help you remember things. For instance, the proper method for preparing fricasseed throttle moth reticulum. Don't breathe in, oh don't breathe in, lest your head begin to swim. Don't contract the throttle moth virus, just don't breathe and you'll survive this. Okay. What this spoon gained as an emblem of your minor telekinetic abilities, it lost. 100-fold is a trustworthy spice transmitter. You probably accidentally made this thing spoon into some kind of high-cooking doodad, like a carapace deturgulator or a stalk sack whisk. You bet a factory out in Worm Barrow full of low-test yellow bloods, doing nothing but bending regular spoons all day so ceruleans can sell them for a huge profit. Okay. Spice, spice. Let's see. Spice up your stripes. This is an optional rule set for using spice mix in combat, which you think is, pretty ridiculous. You add several recipes from your cookbook to the blank pages in the back of your flart manual. That could be helpful at some point. You give all the spices a little shake in their little vials. They are now much better suited to being added to a broth. Are you sure? You turn to the telekinesis section of the cookbook. Gifted psychics can employ their skills to create culinary wonders that would be otherwise unattainable. Imagine, if you would, a grub cake whose glucose sacs were delicately massaged during braising without the crude necessity of spiking the carapace and spoiling the aesthetic nuance of your plate. It goes on like that, but you kind of checked out after gifted psychics. You barely suppress your arena stickball ingrained instinct to hit things that have been arranged in racks. A daily battle for you, and one you don't always win. This is your 19th spice rack. Sometimes a carapace is way too tough and needs tenderizing. You can buy an expensive carapace tenderizer, or you can beat the bejesus out of it with your Q-bat. Since you're legally required to be poor, you make do with the option that at least feels like arena stickball practice. Okay, I've been running for a while, so... Oh, I didn't want to save over it. It didn't even prompt me. Usually it prompts me if I want to save over. Oh, I didn't. Look at that. It just made a new save game, but okay, never mind. I'll be 16, I think. Well, that was weird. There you go. Okay, outside. Things are looking pretty dicey out there, but Joey Alien needs your help. We hear the music like it's playing in our house. So what is that? Your neighbor's hive is pretty choice, you have to admit. You like your hive, but sometimes you wish you'd been a little older than freshly pupated when the carpenter droids demanded you design it. If you had to do it over again, you'd obviously have included more rumpus rooms. Oh man, a can of claw gunk would really hit the spot right now. That spot being the dead center of your gastric evacuation gland. Ew. Same. Just look. Your neighbor is probably plenty hydrated and also probably cowering for their life if they know it's good for them, which you apparently don't. Your neighbor doesn't play arena stickball, which might be why you've never been all that close to them. But then again, Tetrarch Damoc doesn't play either, so, maybe you just don't like your neighbor all that much? Your neighbor isn't a big fan of your band, probably because they don't know you're in one. You don't really talk to them much. Tetrarch Damoc doesn't like it. Okay, so that's not Tetrarch's hive, okay. He doesn't allow it? What, he's in control of us here? It's not really the best time to be borrowing a spoonful of tube flora shavings. Oh, that sounds like kind of fun. Maybe after you help the alien trapped in Tetrarch Damoc's control room, the two of you can play a nice game of flarp with your neighbor. What a pleasant end that would be to your evening. You live in hope. Your neighbor's hive is pretty far away. You really don't have any kind of psychic potency at this range, or, at all, really. Tensions are already a little higher out here. With the raid and everything. You don't want to freak your neighbor out by charging over there with your Q-bat raised. Hey, what's the deal with that box, huh? I'm kind of ignoring it for a moment. Grub juice is way better than that nasty claw gunk, of course. It's not even up for debate, although that's mostly because publicly expressing a preference for a brand other than the one the heiress endorses would be punishable by culling. Yeah, she's sweet. She's a sweetie. Your playbook encourages you to practice kneeling just in case the heiress ever shows up to a game you're playing in. You felt kind of sick when you read that. She wouldn't be a great audience, even if she were here. which you're very glad to say she isn't. Clogging is gross, no matter how you ingest it. The heiress hasn't done any officially licensed FLARP modules, luckily. If she did, everyone would have to play them, and you'd know they'd just be about how great she thinks she is. Blech. I'm going over there? Oh. Your telekinesis is far too weak to bring down this billboard, which is just as well, since it's probably not a great idea to call attention to yourself right now. Murderous drones flying all around, remember? You seem to have escaped the notice of the drones swarming around nearby. Swinging your cue bat at the likeness of the heiress would change that pretty quick. Okay. Look at this. Looks like it might be some kind of software box. Do we trust this thing? Looks like a software box. Maybe after you install it, you can smash the box against your head? Odd, you hadn't thought about it until you held the playbook, but you do get the same feeling of pernicious intent from that box that you usually do from the man on the moon, the white, non-scoring ball in arena stick ball that pushers aren't allowed to interact with. Like you said, it's odd. You lack the information to put together any kind of cohesive rap about this box. You guess you could rap about how you don't know what it is, but that seems a little too niche to get any real audience traction. Nobody else is going to be listening to it. You're pretty sure you can just open it. Nothing in your FLARP manual about random boxes appearing from unknowable sources, which frankly seems like a pretty big oversight. Oh no, you might crush it by mistake with your incredible power. Probably not. You don't know what it is or where it came from, and you've already decided to destroy it? Wow, you certainly came to that conclusion pretty quickly. It might be time for you to re-examine some of your assumptions about yourself as an open, inquisitive person. Well, thanks for that. Oh! Scratchware received. All future messages to and from this device are protected from third-party surveillance. Sweet! Now we can speak real, brother. As a special one-time offer, all past messages are protected as well. Do you agree that you are already subject to the terms of service? I'm vaguely unsettled by all this. Oh, there's a... Oh, wow.